got my first real six string.
In this video, I want to talk about a really special consequence of what happens in a finite group when all of its Sylow p-subgroups are normal for all of the different primes p dividing the order of the group. So the theorem that we're going to prove is that all of the Sylow subgroups of a finite group G are normal if and only if G is isomorphic to a direct product of its Sylow p subgroups. So what are we going to show? That if for every prime p dividing the order of your group G, there is a unique Sylow p subgroup, or equivalently, that Sylow p subgroup is a normal subgroup. That happens if and only if G is isomorphic to a direct product of its Sylow p subgroups. So in some sense, you can understand this group G in terms of understanding each Sylow p subgroup individually, and then you just need to know some things also about direct products. Okay, so we'll talk about direct products more in a future lecture next week. That's the subject of section 5.1 of Dominant Foot, but what we need about direct products to prove this theorem is actually quite limited, so I wanna give this now as a Sylow theorem application. So first, what is a direct product? We've already been talking about direct products throughout the course, but I just wanna set notation. So let's say G1 up through Gn are groups. The direct product of these groups is also a group. And what is the group operation on this direct product? Well, you do the operation inside each of the individual groups component wise. So like if you have an element A1, A2 up to An, B1, B2 up to Bn, then inside the direct product, the operation would be do the operation A1 times B1 in G1. That's your first component. Then A2 times B2 in G2, and so on up to An, Bn. That's an element in Gn. So where did we encounter direct products before? Well, we saw this exercise 37 in section 3.1. This came up when we were talking about kernels of homomorphisms. This says that if A and B are groups, then if you take the set of all the things in A cross B of the form A comma 1, where A is any element of your group A, this is a normal subgroup of A cross B isomorphic to A. So what's the idea? You show that this is a normal subgroup by showing that it's the kernel of a homomorphism. What homomorphism? Well, the one that is project onto B. So you take the pair A comma B and you just send it to B. So what are the things in the kernel of this homomorphism? Anything where the B coordinate is 1, the identity of B. So that is exactly this set is the kernel. So what we'll need to prove this theorem is just this exercise, but generalized to products of more than two groups. So this is proposition 2 in section 5.1, and we'll get there soon, but the proof is straightforward. So we'll let G1 up through Gn be groups, and we'll say that G is their direct product. For each I, we're going to consider the subset of this direct product where you have the identity in every entry except the entry corresponding to Gi. And there you put in any group element you want, little gi. So this is a normal subgroup of G, isomorphic to the group Gi. And how are you going to show it's a normal subgroup? By showing it's the kernel of a homomorphism. So the name of the game becomes trying to figure out what's the right generalization of this project onto B. And what you want is you want this set of elements to be the kernel of the homomorphism. So you want to send all of these elements to the identity of wherever your homomorphism lands. If you play around with it, the right idea is to take G1 cross G2 cross 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 Gn, that's our direct product G, and send it to G1 cross G2 cross 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 Gi minus 1, but now leave the Gi component out. And you skip ahead to Gi plus 1 cross Gi plus 2 cross 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 Gn. So you just take G1 comma G2 up through Gn, and you send it to the same thing, but where you leave the coordinate in the Gi position out. So it's easy to check that this is a homomorphism. What is the kernel? Well, what are the things sent to 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1 in here? All the things in the direct product that have ones in all of the spots, except they can have anything in the GI spot. So that's exactly what we have here. So what we're seeing is that in a direct product of G1 up through GN, the group contains a normal subgroup isomorphic to each one of the particular factors. So I'm going to pause and erase, and then I'll tell you how to use this fact about direct products to prove this theorem, also using the Sylow theorems as a major input. Let's now see the proof of this theorem. We'll do each direction separately. And let's first suppose that G is isomorphic to a direct product of its Sylow P subgroups. Let's list out the non-trivial Sylow P subgroups. So let's take P1 up through PT to be the distinct primes dividing the order of G. So we know now that G is isomorphic to P1 cross P2 cross 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 PT, where each PI is the Sylow PI subgroup. So it's the unique, each PI is some Sylow PI subgroup. And what we're trying to prove is that there's exactly one. So by this result about direct products that we stated, G, this group that's isomorphic to a direct product of all of these groups, has a normal subgroup isomorphic to this subgroup P1, and a normal subgroup isomorphic to the subgroup P2, and so on. For each I, there's a normal subgroup isomorphic to PI. So what does that mean? PI is some Sylow PI subgroup, but it's normal, which means that there's a unique Sylow PI subgroup. So the fact that this direct product has a normal subgroup isomorphic to each one of the factors means that so does G, that G has a subgroup isomorphic to each one of its Sylow P subgroups that is normal. So normal means there's a unique one, that NPI equals one. Okay, let's do the other direction, where we're gonna suppose that G is a finite group and that NPI is one for each prime PI dividing the order of G. So we're gonna list out those non-trivial Sylow P subgroups. And now we know that there is exactly one corresponding to each PI. Let's call them P1 up through PT, these capital letters. And what we're gonna do is actually write down an isomorphism from the direct product of these groups to G. And the useful thing that we need is our result from earlier, that elements of the Sylow PI subgroup PI and the Sylow P subgroup PJ for different primes, those elements commute with each other. So the elements in P1 commute with the elements of P2. And more generally, for any I and J, the elements of PI commute with the elements of PJ. So now we're going to write down this isomorphism. Let's take phi to be the map from the direct product P1 cross 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 PT to G, where we just take the tuple x1, x2 up through xt to the product in G, x1 times x2 times xt. So I'm going to pause and erase, and then we'll see why this map is actually an isomorphism. Let's finish the proof of this theorem by looking at this map phi from the direct product of these Sylow P subgroups to G that takes the tuple x1 up through xt to the product x1 times xt. Our goal is to show that this map phi is an isomorphism. So first, we want to show that it's a homomorphism. So we can just check what is phi of x1 through xt times phi of y1 through yt. Well, it's a product, x1 times xt, y1 up through yt. But now we know that elements from different Sylow P subgroups commute with each other. So xt and y1 commute with each other. So you can switch their order. And then xt minus 1 and y1 commute with each other. So you can switch their order. So you can walk y1 over to be next to to x1. Then you can walk y2 over to be next to x2. And whenever you have two elements that are in different Sylow P subgroups, you can just switch their order. So you can rearrange so that you have x1, y1, x2, y2, up to xt, yt. but this is phi of x1, y1, x2, y2, which is the product of x1 up through xt and y1 up through yt in this direct product. So what's the big thing we're using? We're using this fact that elements from different Sylow P subgroups commute with each other when it is true that there's a unique Sylow P subgroup of each of those sizes. Okay, now we have to see that phi is injective. So the order of x1 up through xt is the product of their orders. So what is that saying? The only thing that gets sent to the identity is the identity over on the left side, because otherwise the order would have to be bigger than one. And now the last piece is, why is that enough? So we have a homomorphism that's injective between two finite sets of the same size. So if you have an injective map between two finite sets of the same size, it's automatically bijective. So that's it. So what have we done? We've very much heavily leaned on this fact about, in special cases, you can say that elements from different Sylow P subgroups commute with each other. That pretty much gives you the homomorphism property. The fact that this map is injective uses a fact about the order of the product of a bunch of commuting elements in a group. So in the very last video of this lecture, we'll see some applications of these kinds of results to some of the type of group theory problems we've talked about so far.